Very, very dreadfully nervous I had been in M. But why will you say that I'm mad? The disease had sharpened my senses, not destroyed, not dulled them. Above all was the sense of hearing acute. It is impossible to say how first the idea entered my brain, but once conceived it haunted me day and night. Object there was none, passion there was none. I loved the old man. He had never wronged me. He had never given me insult. For his gold I had no desire. I think it was his eye. Yes, it was this. One of his eyes resembled that of a vulture, a pale blue eye with a film over it. Whenever it fell upon me, my blood ran cold. And so by degrees, very gradually, I made up my mind to take the life of the old man and thus rid myself of the eye forever. Now, this is the point. You fancy me mad. Madmen know nothing, but you should have seen me. You should have seen how wisely I proceeded, with what caution, with what foresight, with what dissimulation I went to work. I was never kinder to the old man than during the whole week before I killed him. And every night, about midnight, I turned the latch of his door and opened it, so gently. And then, when I had made an opening sufficient for my head, I put in a dark lantern, all closed, so that no light shone out. And then, when my head was well in the room, I undid the lantern cautiously, cautiously. I undid it just so much that a single thin ray fell upon the vulture eye. And this I did for 7 long nights, every night just at midnight. But I found the eye always closed, and so it was impossible to do the work, for it was not the old man who vexed me, but his evil eye. Upon the 8th night, I was more than usually cautious in opening the door. Never before that night had I felt the extent of my own powers, of my sagacity. I could scarcely contain my feeling of triumph to think that there I was, opening the door little by little, and he not even to dream of my secret deeds or thoughts. I fairly chuckled at the idea. I had my head in and was about to open the lantern when my thumb slipped on the tin fastening, and the old man sprang up in bed crying out, "Who's there?" I kept quiet and still, and said nothing. For a whole hour, I didn't hear him lie down. He was still sitting up in bed, listening, just as I have done night after night, hearkening to the death watches in the wall. When I had waited for a long time, very patiently, without hearing him lie down, I resolved to open a very, very little crevice in the lantern. So I opened it. You cannot imagine how stealthily, until at length a single dim ray, like the thread of a spider, shot from out of the crevice and fell upon the vulture eye. It was open, wide, wide open, and I grew furious as I gazed upon it. I saw it with perfect distinctness, all a dull blue with a hideous veil over it that chilled the very marrow in my bones. But I could see nothing else of the old man's face or body, for I had directed the ray as if by instinct precisely upon the damned spot. And now, have I not told you that what you mistake for madness is but an over-acuteness of the senses? Now, I say, there came to my ears a low, dull, quick sound. It was the beating of the old man's heart. It increased my fury as the beating of a drum stimulates a soldier into courage. It grew quicker and quicker and louder every instant. The old man's terror must have been extreme. It grew louder, I say, louder every moment. Do you mark me well? I've told you that I am nervous, and so I am. And now, at the dead hour of the night, amid the dreadful silence of that old house, so strange a noise as this excited me to uncontrollable terror. With a loud yell, I threw open the lantern and leaped into the room. He shrieked once only. In an instant, I dragged him to the floor and pulled the heavy bed over him. And I then smiled gaily to find the deed so far done. But for many minutes, the heart beat on with a muffled sound. At length, it ceased. The old man was dead. I placed my hand upon the heart and held it there for many minutes. There was no pulsation. He was stone dead. His eye would trouble me no longer. If still you think me mad, you will think so no longer when I describe the wise precautions I took for the concealment of the body. The night waned and I worked hastily but in silence. First of all, I dismembered the corpse. I cut off the head and the arms and the legs. I then took up 3 planks from the flooring of the chamber and deposited all between the scantlings. I then replaced the board so cleverly, so cunningly, that no human eye, not even his, could have detected anything wrong. There was nothing to wash out, no stain of any kind, no blood spot whatever. I had been too wary for that. A tub had caught all. And when I made an end of these labors, it was 4:00, still dark as midnight. As the clock sounded the hour, there came a knocking at the street door. I went down to open it with a light, for what had I now to fear? 3 men entered, who introduced themselves with perfect suavity as officers of the police. A shriek had been heard by a neighbor during the night. Suspicion of foul play had been aroused. Information had been lodged at the police office, and they, the officers, had been deputized to search the premises. I smiled. For what had I to fear? I bade the gentlemen welcome. The shriek, I said, was my own in a dream. The old man, I mentioned, was absent in the country. I took my visitors all over the house. I had them search and search well. I led them at length to his chamber. I showed them his treasures, secure and undisturbed. In the enthusiasm of my confidence, I brought chairs into the room and desired them here to rest themselves, while I myself, in the wild audacity of my perfect triumph, placed my own seat upon the very spot beneath which reposed the corpse of the victim. The officers were satisfied. My manner had convinced them. I was singularly at ease. But ere long, I felt myself getting pale and wished them gone. My head ached, and I fancied I heard a noise. No doubt I now grew very pale. But I talked more fluently and with a heightened voice. Yet the sound increased. What could I do? I gasped for breath, and yet the officers heard it not. I talked more quickly, more vehemently, but the noise steadily increased. I arose and argued about trifles. I paced the floor to and fro with heavy stride, as if excited to fury by the observation of the men. But the noise steadily increased. Oh, God, what could I do? I fumed. I raved. I swore. I swung the chair upon which I had been sitting and grated it upon the boards. But the noise arose over all and continually increased. It grew louder, louder, louder. And still the men chatted pleasantly and smiled. Was it possible they heard not? Almighty God, no. No, they heard. They suspected. They knew. They were making a mockery of my horror. This I thought and this I think. But anything was better than this agony. Anything was more tolerable than this derision. I could bear those hypocritical smiles no longer. I felt that I must scream or die. And now, again, hark, louder, louder, louder. Villains, I shrieked. Dissemble no more. I admit the deed. Tear up the planks. Here, here. It is the beating of his hideous heart.